If fragments of the secret knowledge of ancient civilization science had reached our time, they would inevitably been expressed in the language of symbols, understandable only to a few initiates. Such special language is often due to the fact that the communicated concepts are inaccessible to most of the people. Like in the temple of the goddess Hathor in the Dendera region, southern Egypt. If we isolate each element of the artwork on the panels inside, they can well be just an art object. But combined in a specific order as they are makes one wonder. Could it be a ritualized content of the electric machinery? But there's a problem. We don't have an actual artifact, but an artistic representation of it. This and similar images were hidden in the underground temple crypts, and they were not supposed to be seen by a casual visitor. This is why it is legitimate to assume that being a secret knowledge, it might be heavily stylized to protect its true meaning, similar to the method of steganographic message encoding devised by Francis Bacon. It's when a message itself is visible to everyone, but its meaning is concealed within another message or a physical object. Looking from this perspective, any parts of the technical object, like connectors, cables, and transformer coils, can be presented in an artistic way to secure information. So what we see on one of the six similar objects is a sort of balloon shape started from a flower. There are some people below. The woman seems to be connected to the bulb. Two open arms seem like they are open in front of the snake. There is another entity that has a tail and two knives and looks like a Jeff monkey with the face of a toad. The object below is called Djed. Officially, it is a symbol of a backbone of God Osiris. And this part is considered as a lotus flower. The bulb, according to Egyptologists, represents placenta, inside of which is a snake. This motif is also known as a Dendera light, and by interpretation of it as an electric lamp, but there could be more than that. If it was a technology, it doesn't seem common in Egypt, and that is why it led some researchers to think that it was presented by someone to the temple priests. This is a frequency transformer or radio frequency impedance, an example of modern-era technology very similar to the Djed pillar or a backbone of the Osiris, as it is known from Egyptology. If presented to someone who has never seen anything technological in his life, will he describe it as a backbone? Maybe. And this one is an electron tube from the early time of the radio era. Could it remind some people of placenta? Probably. This transformer has five coils, but the number depends on what is necessary for the electronic circuit. According to ancient legends, the goddess Hathor used some of the depicted objects in her temple to heal people. This aspect brings us back to the first transformer in modern history. That was the Oudin coil, an almost forgotten device, which was a close relative of the Tesla coil. The high-voltage terminal of the coil was attached through a wire to various types of handheld electrodes that can be stylized to any shape to apply the high voltage to the patient's body. To apply current directly to the body surface, a vacuum tube condensing electrode was used. This consisted of a partially evacuated glass tube of various shapes, with an electrode sealed inside, attached to the high-voltage wire. This produced a dramatic violet glow when energized. The glass envelope of the tube formed a capacitor with the patient's body, through which the current had to pass, limiting it to safe values. To apply current to the whole body, a condensing couch was used. This was a bed or couch with a metal back under its mattress, connected by a wire to the high-voltage terminal. Metal handrest electrodes at the sides, which the patient grasped during treatment, served as the ground return path and were attached to the bottom of the coil. Thus, the couch formed a capacitor with the patient's body as one electrode. A throne seat covered in gold could easily serve as such a condensing couch as well. Although technically similar to Djed, only high-frequency transformers as well as radio-frequency impedances are perfectly matched to the temple images. This led us to assume that the Djed could be operational and not just a mythologized symbol, and that it was made by someone experienced in engineering of high-frequency impulse currents. In other words, a specialist in electromagnetism. Another important moment is that the first Djed-like electronic components, like those images from ancient Egypt, entered the modern era around the 1930s, only when radio technology was invented. When Auguste Mariette published his fundamental work on Dendera, Thomas Edison had not invented the incandescent light bulb yet. It should also be noted that the famous scientist Sir William Crookes was carrying out his experiments around the same time and created a series of ampoules with a highly rarefied atmosphere. These were famous Crookes tubes, the same ones that later allowed Rntgen to explore radiation effects and discover X-rays when they were powered by high voltage. This is the first X-ray machine of 1895. And if we will overlap these two devices, we will get an almost perfect match. The match is not just by appearance, but most importantly by the structure of these objects. The anode, positive one, in the Crookes tube is in the exact place where the Djed pillar has been placed. Another match is that the main wire connected exactly where the flower is. Here are some other Crookes tubes of the same era. In comparison to the first one, some are very similar in shape, and some are not. Was his original design a serendipity? Dr. Clarbruno Vidruccio, inventor, ex-Italian Navy commander, and engineer, doubts that. He pointed out that an old Crookes tube shows not just similarity, but astonishing identity. Too much to be just a coincidence, because the similarity is to the extent of the exact positioning of the key elements in the design. It's hard to see, but there are two men in the image holding that lamp. Can it in fact mean that this object has more than one function? In one of the issues of the Scientific American Journal, the following diagram as a part of a project for amateur scientists was published. This device is sort of a high-voltage generator that allows it to start producing a plasma discharge inside of the lamp tube. It was a DIY generator of X-rays, and the energy produced by such a small lamp was quite enough to pass several materials. But we'll return to this moment later. On the other bas-relief, there is another strange apparatus. It has a sort of lines that go from the object on the left-hand side. Very often referred to as a necklace, it also resembles a stylized technological object of some kind. If one of the interpretations of these elements as electrical wires is correct, then the spheres could in fact be the beads that served as insulators. In fact, we used a similar kind of technology until the end of the 1970s in a lot of electrical equipment, whenever there was a need to insulate high voltages and high temperature, in appliances like radars, in the home iron heaters, and many other products. The object is connected to a kind of battery, which is connected to something else that seems like some sort of distribution device. It reminds of a similar approach of circuitry that has been used in old cars, and specifically in petrol combustion engines, because it was a simple and efficient way to maintain continuous electric discharge. But why would Egyptians need an electric pulse generator and electric discharge? This is Roberto Volteri and his own working replica of a Baghdad battery. As it was shown, it works, and when powered by vinegar solution, it can provide some electricity current. So we know that some understanding of this technology was present in ancient times. But is it possible that other types of batteries were also known? On this panel, there is a depiction that resembles some sort of a voltaic pile. The first electrical battery that could continuously provide an electric current to a circuit. It was invented by physicist Alessandro Volta. Volta demonstrated back in 1794 that when two metals and brine-soaked cloth are arranged in a circuit, they produce an electric current. Later, Volta stacked several pairs of alternating copper and zinc discs as electrodes separated by cloth soaked in brine to increase the total electromotive force. When the top and bottom contacts were connected by a wire, an electric current flowed through the voltaic pile and the connecting wire. So, probably they had means to generate high-voltage discharge. and it could happen that they had an X-ray lamp, most likely the only one. But what could the X-ray lamp have been used for at the Temple of Hathor in Dendera? Whoever had this object back then most likely was interested in one particular effect of the X-rays: to stimulate fluorescence of crystals or minerals. Michael Faraday was the one who coined the phrase radiant matter to describe what he believed was the fourth state of matter. 60 years later, Sir William Crookes was one of the first to truly experiment with this fourth state of matter. In the early experiments, he placed rubies into vacuum tubes filled with a rarefied gas. There was anode positive on the one end and the cathode negative on the other. He introduced sufficient voltage to ignite a radiant matter, and rubies started glowing red. Crookes talked a lot about radiant matter and phosphorescence in his work. The radiant matter is now called plasma. It's interesting that if such technology existed in the ancient world, it could be replicated in other artifacts. And in fact, it might have been a very famous one, the owners of which just left ancient Egypt during biblical Exodus, the high priest breastplate. According to some legends, its crystals glowed, and in that way communicated the god's message. If you'll read Crookes' work and then study photographs taken by Christian Birkeland and his laboratory experiments, you will find very interesting things. In his Torella experiments, Birkeland used an electrified globe in a vacuum chamber. The images he produced are remarkably similar to modern photographs of the sun. Robert Quinn and Ralph Fiorito produced similar images in 1967 while attempting to generate plasma stability. If an underlying process is charged plasma affecting matter of a different electrical potential, what if that might actually be the process that makes stars shine? Is it the same thing that we see on one of the Dendera's bas-relief, the plasma doughnut? If such artifacts were found by other cultures that invade Egypt, they wouldn't survive. They would be destroyed to take the copper from the coils and other precious metal from the inner working of the glass or crystal of the bulb. As for the text descriptions, we have to consider that a lot of panels were stolen. That makes it even harder to understand the place of electromagnetism and plasma in ancient Egypt. But even what was left is a sort of time capsule in stone, where one can see outstanding similarities with technologies completely out of its time.